Good morning. Welcome. It is good to gather. Surely God is in this place. Help me notice. Welcome. And thank you for joining us on this 15th Sunday after Pentecost. It is creation time one, a time to be creating and celebrating. Today, we are so excited to have some of us joining here in person for worship. We'll also have folks who are receiving this by post mail, by email, possibly online. So we're going to keep figuring it out as we go along. First off, though, I'd like to acknowledge Carol Boyce and her team. They were the reopening gathering team that put together all the protocols and submitted it to our regional council for approval and kind of did all the legwork to get us here this morning safely. So let's acknowledge that team if we could. Thank you so much. Reminder that the children are with us in the sanctuary throughout worship as we share this intergenerational service. We do look forward to your feedback as we try to figure things out as we go along. We are an affirming ministry of the United Church of Canada. Wherever you are, whoever you are, there is room for all. And at this time, I'd like to invite Cliff forward to light our candles as Brenda plays for us sweet music that we have missed so much. As we light this Christ candle, we invite Christ right where we are. May we experience Christ's love and light, filling every part of our being. Come and see hope alive right here, right now. God reminds us that we are all the same and that forgiveness and grace are for everyone. As we light this candle for our community, we invite Christ's love and light to be poured out on our neighborhood and wider community, filling all with new hope, healing, and peace. Come and see, as we give God thanks and praise, we come to worship the God of life and love. God invites all to the table of welcoming hospitality, nourishment, forgiveness, and acceptance. As we light this candle for our world, all of creation, we invite Christ's love and light to be felt everywhere. May the power of peace bring healing in all the hurt of our world. And for those at home, I invite people to light a candle or turn on a light source, or just hold your awareness of Christ's presence within you. We are Christ. Christ's light and love shines in us, through us, around and beyond us, to our neighborhoods and communities, and to all creation. And I'm going to offer our acknowledgement for the lands in case you've not been following protocols. Unfortunately, we are not allowed to do choral speaking or singing, which means we will not be talking all together. We will not be doing responses this morning. And when we come to the Lord's Prayer, I invite you to mouth the words or whisper them quietly. We acknowledge and respect this land of the Anishinaabe Mississauga peoples, with whom Treaty 20, the Williams Treaty, was signed. On the lands where we are, and we acknowledge also and give thanks for the lands and people of treaties and unceded territories of all who are worshiping. It is up to all of us to live into truth, respect, and reconciliation with all our relations. And as we share this sacred time, in whatever space we find ourselves, feel the presence of God. As you welcome God, God welcomes you. We praise God to be able to gather in joy. We are transformed by God's grace. Now is a time of celebration. God is with us. Come experience God's mighty presence. And I invite you to pray in whatever way is comfortable for you, opening yourself to receive God as we ground and center ourselves. We still ourselves to experience awareness of our own breath, filling ourselves with the fullness of life's breath, of God in us. Breathe it in and release it out into silence. Receive now this ministry of music in a time of quiet meditation and gratitude as we listen to Creation Calls. It will be on the screen.
That's the announcements one. You're in the wrong one. Yes. No. Left. Yes. Scroll forward. There you go. Whoop. Back up. There it is. Click on that. Yep.
Thanks, Christina.
Okay.
And with thanks to Brenda for that offering this morning, let us continue in prayer. When God first walked among the trees in the first garden, God called to the people from amongst the trees, "Where are you?" For they hid from God. And so we pray, O God, you called to the people from the trees, call to us now. O God, when we have forgotten to breathe deep and our hands are clenched, may your trees remind us to breathe. For those whose breathing is hard, loosen lungs and chests, grant them ease in breathing. Jesus Christ, you sat under the trees, prayed under the trees, gathered with friends on hillsides, and rested in the leafy shade. May you offer rest to those who need to rest, and restore those that need strength and help. Holy Spirit, holy wisdom, holy dove, perch on the branch of the tree of life, be our inspiration. Perch outside parliaments and governments, outside the homes of leaders and offices of the powerful, and whisper wisdom to them for this time. In the name of God the Creator, Christ the Wanderer, and wisdom who plays in creation. Amen. And at this time, I invite us to enjoy this video together for the young and young at heart. Amen and Praise the Lord is its title.
I'm
Thank you. And that also is a thank you to Brenda. Let love guide your path, for love is the holiest path of all. You are beloved and blessed by God to be a blessing to others. Today's reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 and 22. And Ariana is going to be reading from the New Revised Standard Version.
When Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if there is not a member of the church who sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times?" Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you 77 times. Thanks to be God."
Thank you, Ariana. I am reading the same passage from the New International Version, the NIV. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister's sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77. Listening again, this time from the New Living Translation. Then Peter came to him and asked, "Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? 7 times? "No, not 7 times, Jesus replied, "but 70 times 7. May the word of the Lord speak to our hearts. Invite us now to receive these words as we hear this hymn, "Morning Has Broken," also with a thanks to Brenda.
Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times.
You've got to be kidding. 77 times? You're nuts.
That's what he said.
Listen, I'm no pushover. I'm willing to let bygones be bygones and all that other stuff, but I won't be forgiving anyone 77 times. I can tell you that.
Then you aren't really forgiving them, are you?
Well, sure I am. I mean, I won't be a doormat. What difference will it make if I do forgive 77 times or even more?
Maybe then you will truly let go of the hurt and step out of the pain. That's what forgiveness is all about. Not just speaking the words, but actually letting go of the situation. It doesn't mean that you will have to let the hurt happen to you over and over again. It means that you will lay it down. You will have learned something about yourself as well as the one who hurt you.
You mean I'm supposed to learn something from all of this?
Absolutely. Do you think God retains God's disappointment over you when you fail and fall short? God forgives, wipes the slate clean, gives another chance, time and time again. That's what God wants us to do, to live lives of forgiving love.
But it's not that easy.
God is with you. You will always have help with this.
You're sure of that? Really sure?
Without a doubt.
May the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all of our hearts be open and acceptable to you, O God. May we offer forgiveness and share kindness and compassion, always seeking to be our best selves and to live in your way of love. In Jesus' name we ask, amen. How can we be our best selves, especially if we are hurt, angry, or mad because of the way we've been treated? Think of someone that you're maybe feeling a bit mad at, or a whole lot mad at. Think of ways that you've been hurt by others. It's not nice. Think of times when you've had ideas that you think it would be good to pay them back. They deserve it, after all, for hurting you. Sometimes we know that we've been hurt, and we know that we're right, and they are most definitely wrong. Sometimes we feel that we're even entitled to stay mad because the person has hurt us. Perhaps someone's used mean words, harsh tones, expressed cruel words of bullying in some way, or hurtful in other ways. Jesus' disciple Peter must have been wondering about this when he asked Jesus about how many times he should forgive someone. In the time that Jesus was living life on earth, the common thinking in Jesus' day was that you only had to forgive 3 times. Peter obviously thinks he's being very generous by saying he will forgive 7 times when someone has hurt him. This is double the teaching plus 1, after all. And 7, we know, is a special number in Hebrew teaching. We can think about 7 days in a week, 7 seas of creation, 7 colors in a rainbow. Or in the story from Matthew's gospel, we might think about the sharing of 7 loaves shared among the crowds with 7 baskets of leftovers. As we think about it, we wonder how many times to forgive. We might remember one time that a person hurt me, even two or three, but after that, we wonder, do we have to forgive any more? After all, you've given them lots of chances. Can you imagine Peter thinking, how about seven times, Jesus? Maybe Peter had a pretty good memory and thought he could keep track and remember seven unkind things that someone did to him. But he must have been very surprised when Jesus said a whole lot more. In some Bible translations, it says Jesus said 77 times, and in others, 70 times seven. Did you notice that difference in the different translations we shared this morning? Scholars, the people who study the Bible, teach us that this is not an example of someone making a mistake in their writing, but instead about the original language being used in Jesus' time. From the Hebrew, the translation is 77. And from the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation, both languages were common at the time of Jesus, the Greek translation would be 70 times 7. Now, 77 and 490 are very different numbers, but scholars say it's not about the math. That's not what to focus on. We need to focus instead on what Jesus is teaching Peter and us about forgiveness. We can't keep track of 77 wrongs or 490. Jesus is saying we should not try to keep track. That is not a healthy thing for our brains to focus on. Another connection that Bible teachers often make comes from a story in Genesis 4. Lamech was a descendant of Cain. You might remember from the Bible the story of the brothers Cain and Abel. They fought a lot. Generations later, there is still anger, resentment, and they're still not working on forgiving or showing love or kindness or compassion. All these generations are still angry, still trying to take revenge and be mean on purpose. In fact, Lamech is showing off and boasting, proud of his bullying and meanness. In Genesis 4:24, if Cain is avenged sevenfold, then Lamech 77-fold. Lamech says that he has avenged more than Cain. It was like there was a family feud that just kept on going, and they were acting like it was a contest to see who could keep being mean and hurtful. But Jesus turns the statement of revenge around and says, the number of times we must forgive instead of show revenge. Jesus teaches the disciples and us to forgive as many times as it takes. Richard Rohr writes, our best self wants to restore relationships and not just blame or punish. This is the economy of grace, restorative justice, a justice that seeks not to punish, but to heal. We need to figure out how to be our best selves. And in the next part of the story that follows in Matthew's text that we did not read, Jesus tries to help the disciples understand by sharing about a man who owed a king a lot of money. The king gave the man another chance after the man pleaded. The king showed him compassion, forgiveness, and let him go. When the man was leaving, glad to be free and having this second chance, he came across another person who actually owed him a little bit of money. This is where the guy blew it, big time. He got angry at the man who could not pay him back the small amount of money. It's like the guy completely forgot how nice the king had been. Instead of showing compassion, he threw the man who owed him a little money in jail. And when the king found out how mean the man had been, who had not shown forgiveness, he was very angry. Whether the problem is big or little, we should try to forgive, and God will help us when it is hard. In a resource called Boundaries, the author uses an image about people taking responsibility for their actions and when we sometimes need help. He said to imagine that sometimes we have burdens, really big things that are bothering us, like crisis and overwhelm. And that when there is this excess of burdens, it's like it's great big boulders. We can't move them. We can't do it on our own. But we can turn to others and to God to help us manage those burdens or boulders. In the Greek, burdens is the excess burdens, the too heavy stuff. In Greek, the word load means to carry our everyday responsibilities, the kinds of things we would expect to do and be responsible for, like our attitudes, our words, our behaviors, and our choices. That's on us. He said to imagine it like a backpack. We can carry our load in our backpack. That's our responsibility. But when it's really big, then we reach out. As we think about it, sometimes it's hard to know what we should do. Sometimes things are difficult and we don't want to feel alone. We want to try to walk the journey and be kind, to be our best selves. Diana Butler Bass wrote on Friday, "There's a growing scientific consensus that kindness towards others is an important part of well-being and life satisfaction. Kindness lends stability to marriages. It increases our sense of generosity. Acting kindly makes one happier. Kindness improves heart health and positive emotions. Being nice to other people makes you nicer. The empathy and compassion to spark kindness are necessary to imagining justice and developing courage." We are all trying to live in a good way. But we do hurt people we love sometimes, and they also hurt us sometimes. Jesus says, don't keep being mad, don't keep count, but try to figure out how you can forgive and show love. Love, mercy, compassion, all comes down to loving one another the way God loves us and treating others the way we want to be treated. We don't want to take revenge, even when it feels like a good idea in our mind. We do not want to create divides. We don't want us and them. We don't want to tear people down. That won't help. We want to accept people where they are. Sometimes it means taking a deep breath, counting to 10, taking a time out, a cool down time, going and taking time to pray and get calmer. We need to ask ourselves, is there a way to respond in love? Too often we judge others and we feel judged ourselves. We might want to respond negatively, but it never helps if we try to make ourselves bigger by making someone else smaller. It's not about being entitled or being right. It's love, creating space for understanding, kindness, and compassion. This week, as we go through our days, let's be aware of our attitudes, our tones, our words that we use, and that others use with us. If we can step back from judging and from allowing ourselves to just react in a hurt way, and start to observe it, to bring curiosity or wondering to what is happening, sometimes we can discover some new possibilities of how to approach forgiving in love. We create the space to be our best selves, living God's way of love 70 times 7. Thanks be to God. Amen. And as we prepare to come into a time of prayer, reflecting on God's incalculable love and the incalculable love, number of times our hearts can carry on in love and make loving choices, I'm going to ask Brenda to just play quietly today while we come together in this time of prayer. And I will remind you that at the time of the Lord's Prayer, I invite you to voice it quietly, mouth it, whisper it, but not to use a big voice. Thank you. Brenda, let us pray. Loving God, help us walk the way of love, to be our best selves, to show forgiveness, kindness, compassion. We thank you, God, for all who have come here today, for those at home and in other places, reminding us that our family of faith is everywhere. Keep all safe and well. Help us make good choices in our words, our actions, our behaviors. When it is not easy, help us share our burdens with people we trust, and help us to try to understand and not judge others. We pray for all those dealing with physical, emotional, mental, spiritual difficulties, their care providers, those at home, in nursing homes and in hospitals, those facing illness, bereavement, and other life challenges. Lord, we pray for all who are lonely and afraid, living in difficult situations. We lift to you, O God, the cares and concerns of our hearts. And we lift to you, O God, our joys and our celebrations, our thanks, and our gratitudes. Gracious God, Father and Mother of us all, you are our water of life, sustaining and filling us with renewal and hope. You are the sanctuary that gives us strength in all the times and seasons of our lives. We give ourselves and our gifts, all that we have to share. We ask your blessing upon gifts offered through PAR, through the offering of our hearts, our gifts, our skills, our talents. Continue to use us as you bless us and these gifts, so that others may share in the presence of your love and light here and throughout the world. as we pray together the prayer that Jesus said with his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And enjoy this hymn as we go forth. This little light of mine. May our feet tread the road of peace. May our arms share the hand of peace. May our voice bring a word of peace. May this light breathe God's peace. Shalom, wherever we may go. And I invite us now to enjoy the familiar words as Brenda plays for us this instrumental gift of music. Go now in peace.